So welcome to the tutorial session. So this afternoon, the tutorial will be given by Emmanuel Prouff. So Emmanuel is one of the best experts in the field of crypto implementations and sidechannel attacks and sidechannel countermeasures. So we are very happy to have him as for giving this tutorial. So this afternoon, he will speak about securing cryptography implementations in embedded systems. So thank you, Emmanuel.
Thank you for the introduction. Thank you, everybody, for being here instead of visiting this very nice city. Thank you to the PC chairs for the invitation. So the purpose of this tutorial is to present you some concepts and some methods which are used when it comes to implement cryptographic algorithms in embedded systems with limited resources, like, for instance, a smart card. So the core observation of sidechannel analysis and the field of sidechannel analysis is that the behavior of a device on which a cryptographic algorithm is processed depends on the values which are manipulated during this processing, and especially depends on the some parts of the secret parameters which have been used for the cryptographic algorithm. To illustrate this, let us focus on this very simple processing. So here I have an S-box, for instance, operating on the bitwise addition between a known part X and a secret part K. So X is assumed to be known by the adversary, and K is the secret part he wants to recover. And I denoted by Z the output of this processing. So I'm running this process on a smart card. And during this processing, I am measuring the power consumption. So here I choose, the value of the key equal to 1. So I'm measuring the power consumption for, let's say, 1,000 operations for 1,000 different values of X generated at random with a non-uniform distribution. So during this processing, I am measuring the power consumption. So I get 1,000 measurements. And from those measurements, I am building the distribution of the power consumption over the time. So, and I get something like that. So here in x-axis, you have the time. So this is essentially the period dedicated to this processing. In y-axis, you have the value of the power consumption. And in z-axis, you have the probability that some given power consumption value is taken at some time. So this is what I get for key equal to 1. And this is another PDF I get for key equal to 2. And so we observe that this distribution is not the same and depends so on the value of the key. And I can repeat it for key equal 3, key equal 4, and so on. Actually, this is just to show you that there is indeed a dependency, a one-to-one correspondence between the distribution of the power consumption during the processing and the value of the key which has been used to parameterize the processing. In fact, most of the studies dealing with sidechannel analysis or countermeasures, most of the studies dealing with sidechannel attacks will try to exploit in some way this dependency to perform a distinguishing attack and to recover the key. So the field of sidechannel analysis, so essentially the chess community, so the subjects studied by this community can be split into two main families. So the first one deals with the attacks, and the second one deals with the countermeasures. So the main issue for the attacks is the following one. So against each crypto system and each implementation of this crypto system finds the most efficient SEA. And this problematic, this big problematic, comes with some sub-questions like how to define the efficiency of sidechannel attack, which attack parameter to improve, are there side channel analysis common trends between all the attacks which are developed each year, and also the problematic of distinguishing the concept of an attack from the concept of a characterization. This was a little bit the subject of the presentation by François Xavier yesterday. During this tutorial, I will focus on the second problematic. So I will not enter into the details of the questions regarding the attacks. For the countermeasures, the main problematic is for each crypto system, build, find efficient and effective countermeasures. Efficient meaning that it must be practical, so it must be it must work in a reasonable time with reasonable resources, and effective in the sense that it will indeed defeat all the practical attacks which can be performed against my product. And especially the attacks which can be performed by a security lab. So I don't want perfect security, I want to avoid a security at a reasonable cost. So once again, this problematic comes with some questions. So first, how to formally define the fact that a countermeasure defeats some such an attack? Which countermeasure for which such an attack? And what makes a crypto system more vulnerable to such an L than another crypto system? So are there some structures which are favorable to such an attacks and other ones which render the algorithm more resistant to such an attacks? Okay. I'm pretty sure that I don't have to convince you that when we want to build a countermeasure and we want to guarantee the security, we also want to formally define what is the security, what is the strength of the adversary, and so on. So we need more security models. So I'm pretty sure that I don't have to convince you, but most of the time in the industry, this is something which is not so obvious. And when we build models, we have to start by convincing our boss or sometimes also our colleagues that we need models before defining the countermeasures. And for instance, if we want to prove that, we have to look at the literature, and from the beginning when people started to work on this subject, they tried different solutions, but without formally proving the security. And of course, most of the time, because there was no proof of security, there was attacks quite efficient against the countermeasures which were developed at this time. And even for some countermeasures with proofs, because a proof can be flawed. So are they sufficient? So is it sufficient to have a proof in some model? So the answer is no, because the model can be imperfect, and so having a proof for a countermeasure is not sufficient. And after proving the countermeasure, it's better, especially if you want to put the countermeasure in a project, to test it on a lab. So with real measurements running on a real product, so a product which doesn't necessarily follow the model. So an attempt to sum up this slide: proofs help designers. They help designers to achieve measurable security. So they will help because with the proof, I will be able to guarantee that if the model is good, then my countermeasure is effective. But they do not prevent evaluators to test theoretically impossible attacks, because most of the time they apply. So introduction of the different countermeasures. So the main remark, as I showed you in the first slide, is that there is a dependency between the device behavior and the value of the secret parameters. And if I try to formalize what is the efficiency of a sidechannel attack in my field, I will say that the efficiency of such an attack is related to the amount of measurements I need to extract from the measurements information which depends on the secret parameters. And what has been shown is that this efficiency depends on the noise in the observation. For instance, if we model an observation like that, so an observation during the manipulation of the value z by the device as an unknown function operating on this value plus a noise, then we see that if I remove the noise, so it's obvious from the adversary to mount an attack just by observing this. And the difficulty for the adversary will be to remove or to average this noise in order to extract information from the measurement. So the core idea in the countermeasures we are going to build is to define mechanisms to increase this noise, or in other terms, to decrease the signal to noise ratio. So a first solution to do that is to increase the noise in the component. So this can be achieved by adding processing which are not dummy processing during cryptographic processing in order to hide the sensitive processing among very dummy operations, but this is very costly, and most of the time we don't want to do that. So the other idea we are going to develop here is to use secret sharing techniques to split the processing and the data in such a way that the adversary, in order to recover the sensitive information and to recover the information related to the secret parameter, we'll need to combine noisy informations. So for instance, if we want to operate on Z, an idea can be to first split Z into D shares. So this is done during the personalization of the device. So the splitting of Z itself is not done on the device, but before. And then on the device, we store the shares. And when we are going to process those shares, manipulate the shares, we will do this manipulation at different times. So each manipulation will be impacted by a different noise. And in order to recover information on the unshared value Z from the D shares D, the adversary will need to combine this observation with this information and so on. And so it will need to combine, to multiply, essentially, this is the idea, to multiply observation noise. So if we assume here that the noise standard deviation here is sigma, then the combination of all those observations to recover, to rebuild information which is statistically dependent on Z will be impacted by noise with standard deviation sigma to the power D. So this is the main reason why we are going to use sharing techniques, or also known in our field by masking, in order to protect implementations, just to increase the noise artificially without adding a dummy operation in the circuit or in the implementations. So against those techniques, the adversary game will be in the implementation, find the first thing he has to do is to find D or less intermediate variables that jointly depend on the unshared value Z. So if if I can prove that such tuple of less or strictly less than d variables does not exist in my implementation, then I can say that I have a security. I will say that I have a security at order d. And so the developer game will be to ensure that such tuple does not exist and to prove that such tuple does not exist in some model. In the rest of my talk, I will consider that I will see an implementation as a sequence of elementary operations which read memory location and write its result in another memory location. So I will be in a model which is sometimes named only computation leaks. But I will assume that when I'm measuring something during processing, I'm just measuring something which is related to this processing. So there is no remanence or there is no cache effects which relate my measurements at time t at some things which happened at times t prime strictly smaller than t. Okay, so what are the different approaches which have been followed to apply those techniques? So there are essentially two big approaches which have been followed. The first one is to design algorithms, cryptographic algorithms, which are inherently resistant to sectional analysis under some model. And essentially, this approach is born with the work of Dibrovsky and Petrozak in 2007 with their Stokes paper. And it interests a lot what I call the cryptography, the theoretical cryptography community. Who propose a lot of models and a lot of constructions of cryptographic algorithms, which are inherently, meaning that I don't have to take care during the implementation of those algorithms about the side-channel attacks. I should not, and they will defeat all the attacks, at least in some models. So the models which have been developed in this approach are, for instance, the bounded retrieval model, which assume that the overall sensitive leakage is bounded, which does not really fit the reality. So they propose a more realistic model, which is a leakage resilient cryptography, the continuous leakage resilient cryptography model, in which we assume that the leakage is limited for each invocation only. But once again, the problem with those models is that they are too strong. Especially for the BRM, for the LRC, the models are too strong, and so the constructions are far from being practical. And the second problem of this approach is that it allows us to define to build cryptographic algorithms, which are inherently resistant, but it does not show us how we can protect an existing algorithm, for instance, like AES or RSA. So it's not this kind of approach which can help us to protect the most of the products. So that's why we try to follow another approach, or as I explained in previous slides, which is based on secret sharing techniques. So the first idea has been proposed of using sharing techniques to protect cryptographic implementations, have been introduced in two papers simultaneously. A paper by Gubin et Patarin in 1999, and a paper by Shari, Jutla, Rao, and Roaji in 1999 at Crypto. So the soundness of this approach. So this is a formal way how to present the ideas I showed you in three slides. So the core idea is that is the following one. If we speak about a bit, if I share one bit x into d plus one shares, and if I add the normal Gaussian noise with mean with standard deviation with variance sigma square, then the the complexity, the number of observations needed to distinguish the distribution of the observations Li when the shared value, the shared bit is zero, from the distribution of those observations when the unshared bit is one, is lower bounded by something which is which increases exponentially with the number of shares. So this is a very important observation, and which explains that we can build security if we have noise. So here we see that the importance of noise is crucial. If we don't have noise, sharing techniques does bring no security. So we will use the noise provided by the device. So what we call the electronic noise, also the observation noise coming from the experimentation, and we will increase it. We will find the appropriate D to get the certain level of security. Now I show how we can split a value into shares, and in order to protect the manipulation of a value. But now what I would like to do is to process on a sensitive value. So my second question is how. Can I securely process a value which has been shared while maintaining the security at order D? And not only I have to find techniques to do that, but also I have to find models in which I can prove that my implementation is secure. So for this purpose, in order to prove the soundness of my approach, I have essentially two solutions, two models. The first one is a probing adversary model, which has been introduced by Ishai Sai-Wagner in a paper at Crypto in 2004. And another approach is to use an information bounding model. And in fact, we are lucky of the two approaches can be unified, and have been unified in a paper at Eurocrypt by Duke Dziebrowski and Faust. This is quite important because this model is comes with quite effective techniques of proof. But it is limited to some adversary who can only probe some wires in a circuit, where a circuit is just an abstraction of a program. So we split a program into elementary operations. Most of the time, those elementary operations are bitwise additions and multiplications, for instance. So, for instance, a Boolean circuit is typically bitwise addition and XOR get and get, but we can extend the definition to any kind of processing in any field. And so, in the probing adversary model, the adversary is assumed to be able to probe, so to observe the output of each get, so of each elementary operation. And if we say that the adversary is at order D, we limit the number of probes, so of intermediate results he can observe, to D. So he is not allowed to observe more than D intermediate results. So we see that we have model quite easy to deal with if we want to perform proofs, but it's not very practical because nothing. Should prevent the adversary to observe D plus one intermediate results instead of D. So that's why the second model has been introduced, which is essentially to say, I giving the adversary all the intermediate results with noise, so all the intermediate results are noisy. I have applied some sharing techniques to split the processing and to split the manipulation of intermediate results. And this model will try to to upper bound the amount of information which is provided by the tuple, by the full tuple of observations, to the secret parameter. So I try to minimize, to upper bound the mutual information between the observation of all the intermediate results and the secret parameter. And what I've been shown in this paper is that if I can prove the security in the probing model at order d, then I can deduce an upper bound on the mutual information Okay, so most of the time I will use the probing model just to have a first idea of the security of my countermeasure. So if I want to prove the security of my countermeasure at order d equal to 1 or 2, it's quite simple. It's not too costly. I can list all the intermediate results occurring during the processing and check that not only all the intermediate results are statistically independent on the secret parameter, but also all the pairs of intermediate results are statically independent. So if the processing is not too huge, then I can do that quite exhaustively. We see that even for small orders, this approach is too costly, and we need other techniques. So this is exactly to answer this problem Ishai Saevagner have proposed techniques based on the assignment and simulation in order to prove the security of simple processing at any order d just by with paper and pen and pen proofs. So the idea essentially is the idea of the techniques used by Ishai Saevagner is the following one. So it's a kind of we have two players. So the adversary, who can observe any d-tuple of intermediate results, but not more. And an oracle with access to a strict subset of the input shares. So the oracle has no access to all the shares. So the oracle has no access to information which is dependent on the secret parameter. So this is important because the game is to prove that for any d-tuple of intermediate results, there exists an oracle assignment, so a definition of a simulation, so that this oracle can simulate the adversary's view of the processing. And because this simulation is done with a strict subset of the shares, we are sure that the adversary cannot recover information on the secret based on the observations, because the oracle can do exactly the same thing as the adversary, and the oracle has no access to the secret, has no information about the secret. This method works quite well for simple schemes, for instance, for multiplications. It has been applied in the original paper by Ishai Saevagner, but it's difficult to extend to very general processing. The proofs can be quite difficult to do. Fortunately, there have been efforts by a team of researchers in formal methods, led by Gilbart. So, especially with the paper, there is a paper by Gilbart, Belaïd Dupressoir, Fouque, Grégoire, and Strub, where they show that they have developed a software, which can prove the security of any implementation at any order d in a quite reasonable time. So, quite reasonable time means that we can prove the security for simple schemes, a little bit more complex than what we can do with paper and pen, but not so much. So, But this is already very interesting because it allows to ensure that there is no flaws in the paper and pen proofs. So this is a very very important result in masking countermeasures. So about the information model, I would like to say a few words about it. So the notion has been introduced by Shari et al. At Crypto 99. So this the notion is essentially the argument that if I share a bit into D plus one shares, if I add noise on each share, then the complexity to distinguish the distribution related to the sharing of zero and the complexity and the distribution related to the sharing of one. So the complexity to distinguish those distribution increase exponentially with the number of shares. So this was the result in the 99 paper, and it has been extended in recent papers to the sharing of any data, and also to the sharing of a processing. And the most important fact in this slide is the following one. If I know that the amount of information leaking during the manipulation of each share ZDAI, if I know that this amount of information is upper bounded by this, so by something which is related to D square, then I know that the difficulty to recover information to recover information on the unshared data will increase. Will increase exponentially with D, and so the amount of information is decreasing exponentially with D. So I just have to satisfy this. So if I want to use this result to build a security, either I am measuring the noise in the observation, and hence I am deducing the order D in order to have the, so this is the security. So to achieve the security, I am adapting the noise, or if I want to do the opposite, I'm increasing the noise in order to get the security level that I wish. Okay, let us look at a very simple example of what can be done with sharing for our simple example of the processing of an S-box. So here I just process the S-box, the iOS S-box. I assume that this processing is done on two registers. The first one, R0, is containing the plain text byte. R1 is containing the key byte K, and I save the result in a third register, R2. So I'm writing a very simple assembly code for this operation. So I am assuming that the S-box is represented by a lookup table. And once again, I am measuring the power consumption during this processing for different values of x. So I get something like that. So this processing even it can be seen as very simple, takes some amount of time. It's not performed in one time. It takes some period, and depending on the capacity of the oscilloscope you are using, you can have a lot of measurements during this very simple processing. So if I want to detect, if I want to see whether I have a security flaw in this implementation, so, or in other terms, if I want to detect whether there is a dependency between some power consumption at some time and the value of the secret, I can perform, as discussed in the presentation by François-Xavier yesterday, I can perform a t-test, for instance. So François-Xavier suggested other methods, but I can try this one. So a t-test is simply I just fix the value of the plain text. I am computing the mean when the value of the plain text is fixed. Then I am processing the mean when the value of the plain text is ranging over over the set of a bit values, and I just process the difference between those two means, and to normalize I divide by the variances. So if I have something which depends on the output of the S box, I should see a peak, because here I should observe that there is the mean here is different than the mean here. If there is no dependency, then the mean at the point I am considering will cancel, and so I should have something very small, close to zero. So okay, I do that for this processing, and as expected, I see that there are big peaks here. Which show that there is a dependency. There is indeed here something which is manipulated and which depends on the secret parameter. Okay, so now I can try to securely process this processing, this S-box computation, and for that I can try to apply my sharing techniques. So. In order to do that, a solution is to split the processing of the S-box into sub-processings, very elementary processings. And so, for instance, if I want to protect the IOS S-box, I can describe the processing of the IOS S-box like that. So at least the nonlinear part of the S-box is the processing of the power 254 in some field, in some finite field. And so, in order to get this output, I have a kind of sequence of operations, and so I have to process X3 and so on. Okay. So now my problem of securing the full IOSS box is reduced to secure each intermediate result during this processing. Okay. And especially, here I would like to protect this processing at least at order one, meaning that I want to protect this processing against an adversary who can only observe one intermediate result. So the adversary in my game is not allowed to observe two intermediate results. It does not mean that in practice I will ask all the adversaries against my product to not use two intermediate results. I'm assuming that combining two intermediate results combine too much noise, and so it will be difficult. It will take a lot of. It will require a lot of measurements to extract information from the combining of two points. So I limit the adversary in my game to an adversary who is only able to observe. One intermediate result and not two. Okay, so my problem is to securely process the processing x cube, so the processing x times x square. And so I'm first building a sharing of x. So I'm assuming that this sharing is given to me. And so this is a sharing of x. X is itself the bitwise addition between the M and key and K, so X1 and X2 is related, is defined like that. And now I am developing the processing in order to see how to split this processing into two parts which are separately independent on the secret parameter, or independent on X. So if I'm developing X cube, I have something like that. Because I am in a field of characteristic 2, I get that. So of course I cannot process this directly because here I have x, so this processing is dependent on x. So I'm developing. So this is not dependent of X, this is not dependent of X, but those two monomials are, so it's not sufficient. So I'm adding a random value here and a random value here. And now I am splitting this processing like that. I will say that in order to compute X cube, I first computing Y1, defined like that, then Y2, defined like that, and it can be checked that those two processings manipulate data which are independent on X. Okay, so I said, so I gave you a sketch of proof, but I said that the processing, that the sketch of proof, even in some good model, is not sufficient, and we always have to test it in practice. So I will test it in practice. So I'm developing I'm implementing the processing. So in assembly, I am assuming that I have some tabulated multiplication. In fact, it is not tabulated. I have a function which process the field multiplication with log tables. And okay, I'm not only doing that in order to prevent cache effects and also in order to prevent cancellation of the random values R and R prime which are used here. I also adding some line of codes which zeroize the registers between each operation and which prevent cache effects. So if I do that, with this code and the add-ons I shortly described, then I got power consumption like that. So this power consumption means nothing. So just to see if I can detect or not a dependency, I perform my t-test. As for instance, this is also suggested by CRI. Sometimes it is called also a CRI test, and just a t-test applied to power consumption measurements. And okay, if I do that, I see that indeed there is no peak. So there is no peak in this t-test, which seems to tell me that okay, there is no leakage of information, at least against an adversary who can observe only one intermediate result. Now I would like to see what happens if an adversary is allowed to combine two leakages, so to combine two intermediate results, because of this splitting of the operation, combining two intermediate results should reveal a dependency. For instance, if you just combine x1 plus r prime, okay. Here, when I will process this, if I just combine this with the observation of R, I will have something which depends algebraically from X, and so I should detect a statistical dependency. So I expect to see something if I consider two points. So in order to test this, I'm taking this power consumption, this trace of power consumption, and I'm building a new trace just by multiplying each point in the trace with all the other ones. So essentially, it's squaring the size of the initial trace, and I'm sure that there are points in this new trace which contain information on the two shares, so which contain information on X. So just to verify this with the t-test, I'm performing the t-test on this new trace, and I see indeed that there is a dependency. So this picture, this example, is just to show you an example of the kind of approach which can be followed when it comes to implement a simple processing, like a simple computation, like an S-box. So first, I'm implementing an unprotected version. I am measuring the leakage, and then I'm splitting the processing into here two parts. I'm measuring the leakage, then I'm measuring the leakage when the points are combined, and so on until and I can increase the order of security. So I can increase the order of splitting until I achieve some given level of security. Okay. So now, if I want to formalize a little bit what I'm going to do and what I have to solve as a designers or as a researchers, indeed, I have two problems. The first issue is how to share sensitive data. In the previous slides, I showed you how to share sensitive data bitwisely, so by bitwise addition. But maybe there are other sharings which can be more pertinent for my context. So this is the first issue, and the second issue is, once I have chosen the sharing technique, how to securely process on shared data. In fact, the first issue is related to secret sharing by the techniques proposed by Shamir in 79. Also, it is related to the design of error-correcting codes with large dual distance. In fact, it has been shown that there is a one-to-one correspondence between the two problematics in a paper by Massey in 1993. Also, it has been developed in a recent paper by Zemor, Castaños, and Renner in 2013. And I will come back on this in a few slides. The second issue is related to secure multi-party computation. As recently shown in different papers, and essentially in the original paper by Nikova et al. On threshold implementations. It is also related to circuit processing in presence of leakage. It is also related, as I will show in some slides, to the problem of efficient polynomial evaluation. So, fortunately, this slide just to say that fortunately we have a lot of theory in which we can find ideas in order to solve our problematics. Okay, so the first sharing I can use is the linear sharing. So in linear sharing with parameter n and d, I am splitting the sensitive value z into n shares, and I have some threshold denoted here by d, and this threshold just says that I need at least d shares to rebuild z. Or in other terms, no subfamily of d minus 1 shares z I depends on z. Okay, and in fact, in a very very nice paper by short paper by Massey in 1993, it has been shown that designing linear sharing with parameter n and d is equivalent to building of a code with length n plus 1 and with dual distance d. So the dual distance of a code is the distance of a dual code. Corresponding to the code. So, yes, okay, it's interesting, but who cares? In fact, it's very interesting for us because it gives a general framework to describe and analyze all linear sharing schemes. So, there are many linear sharing schemes that I can use, and it's good to know that I can describe all of them with the same theory. Also, what is nice is that it links my problem of designing of finding a good linear sharing with problems which are well known in a rich community. Okay, just to make some relationship between the linear sharing and the error correcting codes theory. So In fact, sharing a data is equivalent to encode. So if I want to share a data Z, I first generate k random values R1, k minus 1 random values R1, RK minus 1. And I am using a matrix like that. And so here I have my I get my random values here. Here I have Z, and here I have the redundancy in my encoding. So all linear sharing can be described like that. And okay. So I have an encoding. I have a code, a generator matrix in a systematic form. So it can be written like that. And now I know that if I have an encoding of a sharing of a value Z, then when I multiply this encoding by the parity matrix, which can be deduced from the generator matrix in an easy way. So if I multiply my encoding by that, I have to I must get zero, the null vector, which simply tells me that Z belongs to the code. So okay, so it is orthogonal to all the dual code. This is the significance of this equation. Okay, so I just rewrite the previous matrix, and I call it H for parity matrix. And now I have that Z equals that. I'm just rewriting these equations, and I get something like that for Z. And from this equation, I'm just deducing that the masking sharing order, meaning the minimum number of shares Zi which are needed to rebuild Z, is upper bounded by the minimum of the Hamming weight of the combinations of the column of the parity matrix. Okay, good. But what is shown by Massé is that, and it's quite simple, but it's too long to develop here. But what is shown is that, in fact, this is exactly this minimum. So this is the minimum of the linear combination of the column of the matrix of the parity matrix. In other terms, this is the minimum weight of a vector in the dual code, and so this is the dual distance of the code. So this is just to explicit the relationship between the dual distance of a code and the linear sharing. Okay, and now, okay, I can express my Boolean sharing as an encoding by a very simple matrix. Okay, I can just conclude maybe. Okay, just concluding with this slide. So I can express my Boolean sharing like this. So this is a very simple matrix with the identity matrix here and a column with all. All one vector at the end, at the right of the matrix. And also, Shamir secret sharing, which consists in generating a random degree D polynomial Px, so that the evaluation of this polynomial in zero equals my sensitive value Z. So this sharing is equivalent to define a Reed-Solomon code with parameter n plus 1, d plus 1, where d is the degree of the polynomial in Shamir polynomial sharing. So the main issue with linear sharing is to minimize the number of shares for given d. So if I want a security at order, for instance, 2, I want that the number of shares is not too huge, too big. So for instance, I would like to have the number of shares equal to 3 or 4, but not so much. Not too much. Okay, I think we can stop here and make the pause and continue with the evaluations of
yes,
the pause.
Yes, so thank you very much, Emmanuel. So this was the first part of the tutorial. Are there any questions? Maybe if anybody has any question on the first part, or otherwise we can take questions at the end of the tutorial. No questions. Okay, so maybe we can thank Emmanuel for this first part. And so no is the coffee break, and so we meet again at 4:10 in this room.